Good evening and welcome to the beginning of our year's Benedictine Conversations this evening. Our September conversation is entitled Listening for the Grace of Joy. I'm Dawn Carrillo, and I'm the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica here in Duluth, Minnesota. And I'm glad to have you here with us tonight. We're excited to start a new year of Benedictine Conversations after a break over the summer. We'll run this conversation this evening like we have in the last couple of years, where we have a conversation first with our guests. Please feel free to send in comments by chat if you have a comment or a question, and our guests will work with those questions and comments that you send in. So I'm waiting for my guests to come on. There we go. And Sister Jeanne, if you could join us. I'm not sure what's going on with Sister Jeanne. She was here a minute ago. We'll get her on the screen. And while she's figuring that out, I'm going to go ahead and introduce our guests this evening. So as I said, tonight we start a new year with Benedictine Conversations. And it's a really special year, one we're very excited to begin, because we're going to be lifting up and looking more closely at this concept of joy. For this year, we're seeking to understand joy a little better, pondering questions like, what is joy? Where is joy? How do we know joy when we see it, when we feel it? We're barraged in the news and in casual conversations on the street with tough and overwhelming issues that require a lot of attention and care on our part. 2.5 years of pandemic, violence in our communities, wars in our world, climate change and its effects, racism, poverty, mental health issues, to name a few. How are we to find peace in this state of the world? And can we even find joy amidst so much suffering? Here to start us on the way for this year are two leaders in the Duluth community, Sister Beverly Raway, on the screen with us now, prioress for the Sisters of St. Scholastica, and Sister Jeanne Weber, who is the sub-prioress for the Sisters, who I'm hoping will be on the screen very shortly. Our prioress, Sister Beverly, grew up in Hastings, Minnesota, and she's been a member of the Sisters of St. Scholastica for 57 years. She's currently serving in her second term as prioress, having first been elected in 2015. Sister Jeanne, who will be joining us, she grew up in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and has been a member of the community for the last almost 60 years. And along with Sister Jeanne's duties as sub-prioress, she's also the director of liturgy for the sisters. So I want to welcome you here, Sister Beverly, and I think that maybe Sister Jeanne is trying to rejoin us. So I'm going to go ahead and welcome you, and thank you so much for being here with us. Oh, there we go. Thank you. Thank you.
A little help. It was so simple.
Well, I've already introduced you, Sister Jeanne, and just said thank you so much for being here tonight, both of you.
Scared me. I was going to be alone.
Lovely to have you both. For our opening prayer slash meditation today, I want to read a little passage from this wonderful book that I've been reading and that I know, Sister Beverly, you have been, and some members in the community. I'm not sure about you, Sister Jeanne Ann, but this is called The Book of Joy, and it was published in 2016. And it's a book where an interviewer, journalist Douglas Abrams, interviewed the Dalai Lama and Archbishop Desmond Tutu for an entire week. And this book came from it. And it is an absolutely beautiful book for anyone who's looking to read about joy and the wisdom from these two wonderful spiritual leaders. So in this little passage that I want to read, the Archbishop is giving a blessing. And so he says, "Dear child of God, you are loved with a love that nothing can shake, a love that loved you long before you were created, a love that will be there long after everything has disappeared. You are precious, with a preciousness that is totally quite immeasurable. And God wants you to be like God, filled with life and goodness and laughter and joy. God, who is forever pouring out God's whole being from all eternity, wants you to flourish. God wants you to be filled with joy and excitement and ever longing to be able to find what is so beautiful in God's creation, the compassion of so many, the caring, the sharing. And God says, please, my child, help me. Help me to spread love and laughter and joy and compassion. And you know what, my child? As you do this, hey, presto, you discover joy. Joy, which you had not sought, comes as the gift, as almost the reward for this non-self-regarding caring for others." Amen. I was struck in that passage with, it's almost like a synopsis of what they come to at the end of the book. But we're starting at the beginning of our conversation. But the way that he was speaking about joy, I want to talk with you two. You have extensive backgrounds, extensive experience, Sister Beverly, as a teacher, then in nursing and as a nursing educator, and Sister Jeanne Ann in education, parish ministry, various programming in areas of spirituality. So let's start with this very basic question for each of you, and we can start with Sister Beverly. What exactly is joy? How do you think about joy?
Well, some of my reflection comes from what Dalai Lama said in that book, but also from experience that joy is certainly happiness, but it's and it's a feeling, but it's much more than that. I would agree with him that it's a way of looking at life, and it's an attentiveness to the beauty around you, and I think it's a deep connection to the natural world and to the people around you. Joy comes from that. It's something deeper than just an emotion or a feeling, and a sense of solidarity or relatedness to other, whatever it is, and that could, your other could be God too. And so It's a deep feeling of serenity within your day, and being observant and seeing the small things that give you delight.
Beautiful. Thank you. What would you add to that, Sister Jeanne?
Well, just to kind of continue, it's a way of viewing the world. It's a choice, a decision, a practice, a behavior. And it makes us uniquely human. Sometimes we think maybe joy, sometimes people use joy and happiness interrelatedly in the same definition. But it makes us uniquely human, and it is not something superfluous. You know, you think, well, people, oh, they're joyous or happy. You know, you sometimes think that, is there a certain shallowness? Do they really know what life is about? Do they really know that there's pain and sorrow and life isn't fair and isn't easy? So joy is also a deep and strong lifestyle. And I like to think about joy as maybe the roots of a tree. It's very deep, and it's what holds the tree together, because the pillars of joy are faith, hope, love, gratitude, and peace. And also, joy is one of the gifts, one of the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Paul talks about the different gifts, and Paul talks a lot about joy. It's kind of amazing. He suffered a lot, and how come he's always talking about, not always, but talking about joy and rejoice in the Lord, rejoice always? You know, does he really know what life is about? Well, I think he does, or did. But so it's something very deep and very strong. And sometimes maybe we don't always see the full definition or the full reality of that.
Yeah, so a couple of questions from what you've both said here. We're talking about an orientation to the world, a way of living. And the Dalai Lama, they talk about joy being a byproduct of a certain way of looking at the world. Would you agree with that, Sister Beverly?
Yes, I would. So even though there are disasters and pain and suffering, it's the ability to see beyond that. My own experience of a death of one of our sisters very close to me. She was our spiritual director, Sister Elodie. When she died, I felt devastated and couldn't see the beauty around me until I talked that through. And I remember the day that it happened, that I was in a group where we were working with each other in our experiences of God. And I went out, they told us, go out for a walk and see what you see. And I saw a bare tree. It was in the fall and the leaves had all fallen off. But behind it was a green, evergreen tree shining through that. And I thought, it is the experience of being able to see beyond to the greenness and to what is beyond the suffering. So it's a way of looking at the world differently. And I did that day. In the experience itself, I couldn't see the beauty of the stars on a walk. I couldn't see anything beautiful until I had gone through that passageway. I guess it's not looking hindsight. It's looking at it in a different lens. And so I think seeing the world through the lens of joy is what we're really asked and called to do, even in the midst of suffering. As I was just closing my door, a little thing fell off the wall onto the floor, and a little refrigerator magnet that was sticking, but the door, you know, flipped it off, and it was turned over upside down. I picked it up, And it said, serenity is not freedom from the storm, but peace within the storm.
Mm.
And I thought, that's the same thing about joy. You know, joy is not freedom from the storm. And you started this, the presentation, the music you started with was like a storm. And then it went into the beauty of the music and the strings and then ended with this storm again. But I think it's a way of looking at the world and seeing beauty in it, even in the midst of storm, even in the midst of trauma and pain, somehow getting through that and knowing that there is other, there's beyond.
Hmm. Hmm. So it's a little different than happiness. It can be present in suffering in a certain way, not like a giddy joy, but this deep resounding surety or stability. Is that, I know that you, Sister Jeanne Ann, mentioned that people use those words interchangeably, but do you see a difference in them, happiness and joy?
Well, I think it depends how you define words. And I think I see a lot of similarity between true happiness and deep joy.
Hmm.
And the Greeks talked about a eudaimonic joy.
Hmm.
And so, you know, very old, you know, just talking about, so joy's been, you know, and we know they were looking for wisdom, and eudaimonic joy is achieved through experiences of meaning and purpose. So a real part of joy is, what is the meaning and what is the purpose? And it kind of reminds me of Mary Oliver, who says in her poem, The Summer Day, tell me what you plan to do with your one wild and precious life. And so I think we're answering that question all the time because it's unfolding. But what are the goals and what gives meaning? And I'm very interested, like some of the people, like Viktor Frankl, mm. who is in a World War II prison camp, and he was a psychiatrist
mm-hmm.
and a neurologist. And he was giving, he was doing therapy in the camps. And then he wrote that classic book after he got out. He wrote it in 9 days. You know, what is the meaning of life? What is man's meaning? What is
man's search for meaning?
Yes,
yeah.
Right. And he said, because I think meaning underlies joy. And he said, it's meaningful work.
Mm.
And, you know, you just think about that, but, you know, what is work? Yeah. I was just thinking about what is work if you can't work anymore? So what is the work that we are called to? And then I thought, what Mother Teresa said, she said, a smile brings peace. So a smile brings peace, and I believe joy.
Mm.
When somebody smiles, in fact, certain endorphins are released when one smiles. Mm-hmm. But thinking about that, and the other thing that Viktor Frankl talked about for meaning, because that brings joy, was relationships, having people you love and having people love you. And I think we're finding out that more and more, you know, relationships and the importance of them. And he talked about courage. So mm-hmm. I think courage is a very strong virtue, a very strong attribute that's a part of joy, that in the midst of the suffering and the pain, you have the courage to continue. You have the courage to light one candle in the darkness.
And I wonder if the work of joy, as I listen to both of you talk, you know, we entitled tonight Listening for the Grace of Joy, right? And so joy, if we're talking about joy coming from meaning, for us to know the meaning of something, we have to listen and attend to it, right? We have to listen and attend to our experiences, to our lives, to those around us. Is that the work of joy? Because it doesn't sound from how you're talking that joy is just something that hits us. We have to work at it. What do you think, Sister Jeanne-Anne?
Right. I think it is work. I think anything valuable and deep takes work, takes a certain discipline. It's not a word or a word that we like to use, but one of spiritual classics written by Richard Foster is The Celebration of Discipline. And it seems like an oxymoron, celebrate discipline.
Right.
But if you want to get good at an instrument, to play the violin, it's work. If you want to have your body in shape, exercise, work. Mm. And so I think there is a sense to that. And I think part of that listening is, what do we listen to? Because there's so much noise and there's so many things happening. Life is busy. Life is full. And Benedict says, listen with the ear of your heart. And what are we supposed to be listening to? Well, hopefully God's voice, but, and we know God speaks through other people. And one of the things I was just reading or just heard and then saw on NPR was, what makes a person resilient?
Mm.
And it was about, what are your thoughts? Do you listen to your self-talk? because what we say affects how we feel and how we act. And so if we're thinking, why did she do that again? Mm-hmm. You know, don't you think she's going to catch on? Or about myself, gosh, that was really a dumb thing you said. You know, why did you do that again?
Mm-hmm.
So I think listen to our thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
And are they thoughts positive or negative thoughts? Outside the door of our administrative assistant, she has this little calendar. And every day there's something on it to do. And one of them is trash negative thoughts. And I think it is so easy. I mean, when we just think of the war, the pandemic, you know, we can just we're listening to the news.
Yeah.
Not listen to. So what do we listen to? Because that is going to affect how we feel, how we act, and what we do. Because if we listen, I think we're called to act.
So true, so true. And I'm going back to what you were talking about earlier, Sister Beverly. In that moment when you were looking at that bare tree, you know, if you hadn't listened and paid attention, you know, that paradigm shift or that shift of seeing wouldn't have happened.
Yeah. And I think you can look at your whole life that way too.
Yeah.
And the experiences that you've had and reframe. That was part of what this conversation between the Dalai Lama and Desmond Tutu was about, when they were talking about the experiences of their life, and they had gone through so many hardships.
Mm-hmm.
They're being opposed in their ideas. Dalai Lama exiled from his country, imprisoned, but they were able to change those experiences around and to choose joy in the midst of all. You need to choose joy and to look at the positive that came out of an experience. So going back to my own experiences, like I learned what sorrow and grief is, and I can see that you can come through that and that there is hope and positive beyond. And I think for some people, I worry about young people in particular who go through a depressive experience, a rejection from a girlfriend, or and then choose to take their life or to use drugs or to bury the pain. And I think they don't have the experience of having come through something to see the hope that's beyond and to reframe. You may not see it in the experience, but you need people around you to help to see that and to be able to see that there is something beyond and the hope that comes from. But it's a deliberate choice.
Yeah.
Involved. And when it's choosing to reframe that experience. And
to see
the positive that came out of it. And that takes some thinking and some work, as you talked about earlier.
So. Yeah, that was one of the things identified in the book as one of the three or four most important things that you need to do in pursuing joy. I'm curious, Sister Beverly, what did Benedict and Scholastica say about joy?
Well, I was trying to imagine Benedict and Scholastica's life because they were raised, we think as twins, but for sure, close siblings in the little village of the town of Norcia.
Mm-hmm.
And Norcia is a walled city. And I saw it, I visited it. And there's been an earthquake since, and I don't know how much repair has been done, but it's an old medieval walled city. And you know, growing up in a small town, everybody knows everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of imagine that they experienced, you know, everybody knowing everybody else in there and watching out for each other, loving each other, but also saying, you know, that wasn't such a good thing that happened there. And that they had a very close relationship and a sharing of joy within their family and their neighbors and sharing the news of the day and the change of the seasons and all the things that it. So we know that Benedict and Scholastica met. So they had this natural, I think, family relationship and connection, but they also had a spiritual connection, which comes out in the story in Gregory's version. I forget the title of the book. I got it.
Okay.
The dialogues.
The dialogues. Okay.
The second book of the dialogues, where he talks about Scholastica and Benedict meeting on the last day, or the last time that Benedict and Scholastica were together.
Mm-hmm.
And they had an annual meeting at a house somewhere between the two monasteries, and they were sharing in that meeting the joy at a deeper level, a spiritual level, the joys of the spirit and in imagining the joys of heaven in that meeting. And so I don't know if everybody knows this story, but Benedict, following the rules, wanted to leave.
Right.
He couldn't stay. Scholastica asked him to stay for the night and stay and talk, you know, through the night. And so she put her head down when he said no, when he was leaving, and prayed, and God answered her prayer, and a terrible rainstorm came up so that he couldn't leave. And I think that softened Benedict's heart. And I think his writing of the rule from that time on changed. Although it says that she died 3 days later, and he, from that point on in the dialogues, you see his vision of the world opening up, and he saw the world in one ray of light, like one unified, beautiful world where everything was one. And I think that Scholastica and his relationship allowed that to happen.
Mm.
that he saw that beauty. He also saw the vision of his sister going to heaven, another spiritual experience, and of a another abbot, monk, going to heaven in that ray of light. So he had a spiritual experience as a result of that relationship. So there was that difference. So I'm saying, you know, joy comes out of that connection, not just on the, you know, the natural world, but that deeper level. And whether we recognize it or not, we all have a spiritual connection to each other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, I also thought, Sister Beverly, you were going to talk about, well, you didn't want to probably go on too long, but about the storm, because
yes,
she, you know, put her head down and prayed, and this storm came up, and Benedict couldn't leave, and the monks were all upset, the rule, and then she says, well, Benedict, I asked you, and you said no, but I asked my God, and he said yes, and in the painting in the main entrance of the college, you see Scholastica with this little kind of smirk and smile on her face, and so I think there had to be, you know, a certain camaraderie and a joy within their relationship, and mm-hmm. but it does say that the joy comes too. Love and joy come from God, because we just can't do it on our own, because it's just too big. Mm-hmm. Just thinking about the prophet Nehemiah saying, "The joy of the Lord is my strength." Yeah. You think, well, probably life was easy for him, but it wasn't. The Jewish people had just come back from exile. The temple was in ruins. They didn't know how they were going to build it. And the people, you know, were discouraged and so on. And so you'd think, you know, it's too much. But he rallies the people. Joy has an energy. Mm. It's contagious. And it rallies. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is our strength. So mm-hmm. I think it comes from a very deep place spiritually, as mm-hmm. well as psychologically.
We have a question that has come in from Jim Weber. Any mentions, Sister Jeanne Ann?
I hope it's easy.
He says the following: are there different levels of joy? And then he asks, is this worth discussing, or is it too much analysis? A better focus just being open to creation, others, and God. What do you think about that off the top of your head?
I think there are different levels. I mean, I just think of you know, the joy I feel just going outside and seeing a flower, to seeing the sunset. And so then I think, you know, it moves, you know, relationships, friends. And then sometimes the joy is, you know, the joy in sharing, sometimes it's very deep, sharing joys and sorrows. So, and then I think we move to, you know, the joy in the midst of struggle and pain, because we know that God is greater than the pain. That's the only reason. And, you know, I just think of Julian of Norwich. You know, she lived in the Middle Ages during the Black Plague. And then there was a rebellion. Her health wasn't the best. She lived in this little shack next to the church. So she would open her little door and see the church service and mass. And she'd open the door and listen to people and their deep sorrows. Mm. And, you know, and how could she say, all will be well, all manner of things will be well, Mm-hmm. I mean, where did that come from? How could she say that? And so, you know, some of those kind of things help me, you know, the sense of all will be well. There is a purpose. There isn't a meaning. I don't understand it because life is paradox. I could also talk about, I could talk about family joys just experienced in a family reunion. And maybe I will do that a little bit later.
I'm wondering if our capacity for joy changes as we get older, as we reflect more, as we listen more, as we attend more. I'm thinking about something my spiritual director said to me years ago. She said, everything that you have come through up until this point is with you still deep inside you and will carry you through this next thing that I was facing, or, you know, what we were talking about. That caused a deep peace within me, to because it resonated so deeply, and I knew she was right. And even though fear was still there for what I was facing, there was this joy that yes, I can do this. What are your thoughts on that? Either one of you can jump in.
I agree. You know, all the experience are there. I think it's a matter not just of carrying it with you, but of going back to it and saying, what did I learn from that?
Mm-hmm.
Because how did others see it? Because I'm thinking of a particular experience where I had took 171 sophomores on a ecological trip and a biology trip, and some not so nice things happened, and I came back thinking I'm a failure as a leader. You know, I didn't think ahead, I didn't plan ahead, I didn't. And they said, someone again carried me through that experience and said, you're looking at only one thing or two things that happened. What about the rest of it? It's again focusing on, you can always, when somebody says something negative, you can just focus on that one thing and forget about all the other good that happened. And so all the good is there too, but sometimes we have this little lens that says, ooh, if only I'd done this, you know, or
right,
if that was you know, that was my fault. I didn't think ahead, I didn't plan well, I didn't, you know, whatever it is within you. But you have to look at it also as a learning experience, that it's from the negative that we often learn the most.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, you have to look back and reframe it, find some joy back there. Mm-hmm. Even though you might look at it badly. But I think also, I was thinking about, you know, you asked us as we prepared our questions, what was your first experience of joy?
Mm-hmm.
I thought about that, and I thought, you know, just recently two people shared pictures of their newborns with me, and to see the joy of a mother face to face, or in one case my nephew holding his newborn daughter, and to see the joy in his face and in the face of the infant responding to that. I know that happened with me. I know that happened with a lot of us, you know, most of us, that joy right from the beginning is still there. It's still mm-hmm. there, that love of family that's still there. And so I just could imagine my own mother looking at me like that.
Yeah.
And the smile in that baby's face looking into its mother's eyes. It was just precious, just a precious thing.
You're going to make me cry.
I'm wandering, but
Thank you. That's a beautiful image. Beautiful
image. When you talked about carrying things from your past forward, that sustaining joy has, you know, carried me through, I'm sure. You know, right. The love of family, the love of, you know, that connection.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's very beautiful. Thank you for that. When we met to prepare for tonight, Sister Jeanne Ann, you quoted a Swedish proverb. I looked it up, actually, and got some history behind it. But anyway, shared joy is double joy. Shared sorrow is half a sorrow. So I'm wondering, Sister Jeanne Ann, what does that proverb mean to you about how we are to be with one another? And I guess about our connection with each other too. I just want to speak some about that.
Well, just thinking about this recent family reunion, because my nephew got married in Missoula, Montana, and my brother Jim Weber and his wife Chris in Seattle said, "Why don't you come out to Seattle? Fly out to Seattle, visit us for a couple days. We'll take you to Spokane, and you can visit your sister for a couple days and a grade and high school friend I haven't seen for 20 some years. You can visit with her, and then they'll take you to the wedding." And so anyway, I was just sharing with sisters and friends, you know, about this. And I mean, I was happy, but so many people said, "Oh, great, COVID's over. You get to see your family. I'm so happy. You're going to get a vacation. You're going to be gone for 8 days. You can just kind of let some of the challenges of the monastery behind you." And so there was so, my joy just kept increasing as people were so happy for me.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, my joy just kept bubbling over and bubbling over.
You can tell. I can tell you.
Again, right now.
Yeah. And then the wedding itself, just seeing nieces, nephews, and everybody was happy. I mean, there were fights, and, you know, sometimes their parents are, you know, you get tired, you're not sleeping in your own bed. But it was 250 people, joy, dancing, singing, eating. Mm-hmm. Well, then the other thing that I am dealing with is a knee problem. So I have pain in my knee. I have some arthritis. So I'm getting physical therapy and, you know, kind of limping a bit. And so people are concerned, you know, how are you feeling? And, you know, is it getting better? You know, what does the PT person say? And I had some tape on it to try to get it in alignment. Oh, how's it going? People would be, you know, asking me, you know, praying for me amid other things. And also my family, the same thing. Well, do you want to sit in the front seat instead of the back seat? You know, I got a lot of mileage on this. My pain was really being diminished. And then we had a family Zoom session last night, and just talking about the wedding, how joyous it was, and asking each other, because we really care about each other, well, how is your knee? You know, what's happening with it? Just, and so it just, that somebody cares. I think it's easier to deal with pain when you're not dealing with it alone, when somebody, maybe they can't take it away, but they say, "I'm so sorry," or "What can I do?" And it must hurt. And I think, you know, the one with whom we can share our deepest pain and sorrow, you know, is God, you know, the one who really listens, who really knows our pain, who really knows our heart. And that's why the Psalms speak so powerfully to me as we start the day, because so often, you know, they start, many of the Psalms are lamentation of sorrow and pain. And except, I think, for one, they say, "Thank you, God, for your faithfulness. I rejoice in God, for you are with me." And so I'm really blessed in so many ways in my life.
Perfect example of cup half empty or the cup half full, you know, the way we look at life. And then the sharing of joy, the sharing of joy doubles joy, and the sharing of sorrow cuts it in half. That's the proverb. She's an example of that.
Yeah. A living, walking example of it. Yes.
And we don't necessarily take the pain away, but we make it less of a burden, I guess.
Less front and center in our vision.
And in I think in sharing sorrow there's joy. I mean, it's like I think of a, you know, someone who just recently experienced a death, and just the silent embrace and just saying, I'm so sorry. I think there's a recognition of connection and joy in doing that for them, but also your a heart connection that
deep,
deep feeling of serenity. Caring for another.
You know, today we face a lot of challenges. I mentioned some of them at the beginning: climate change, wars, the continuing death toll of the pandemic, and so forth, and just, you know, racism and political divisions and so forth. And always in our homes, we have things that challenge us in our individual homes. In your community, you are facing a population of sisters who are, you know, declining in number. And in other people's homes, they're facing divorces and addictions and all sorts of things. So I'm curious, with you in your world, I'll direct this to Sister Beverly, but in your world, where do you find joy? How do you notice and increase your joy?
Well, I think I have to turn first to our prayer life. In the midst of maybe a stressful situation in the day, challenges, not certainly like those that are facing trauma and death and war and all that, but in this fate, when with stressors or there's a challenge in front of me, going to chapel in those sacred times of the day, I know that I'm in the right place and that my priorities are straight when I go, and I'm at prayer, and I can let the Psalms wash over me. Connect sometimes with only a few words here and there, but that there's joy in the liturgy.
Yeah.
And a calmness and beauty that comes through in that. And then I think the other is in finding beauty and pausing in the day. Me personally, when I'm, you know, between things and I'm heading from one place to another, from one building to another, and I've got maybe something ahead of me, I stop and I pause and I say, I'm on vacation. For 1 minute, I'm on vacation. I just say, I let everything go that's in my brain and my mind. And I've been doing this for years. I don't know where that practice came from, but I say, I'm on my 1 minute vacation. And it allows me to slow down, take a deep breath, and to look around me at what I'm seeing as I'm traveling. And I'm looking out the window and I see the beauty of the leaves turning this fall. I see the outside my window now, even in this evening darkness, the beauty of the balsam fir that's shading my window, and just hearing the bird sounds if I'm outside, and just taking the time to be attentive and to let go of what's inside of me. And as far as community, you know, having come through the pandemic, we recognize that those times when we were, you know, isolated and among ourselves, we learned the beauty of hearing each other's life stories. And we shared more at the table. We were one on one, two at a table. And we started having deeper conversations with each other about just life, you know, and who we were, and letting each other tell our stories. And I think that has brought us a new joy that we didn't have before. And then Sister Jeanne and the rest of the staff have put together monthly community nights that are fun nights where we don't have a topic to discuss or an article to read. We have just a sharing of fun, ending with Compline and a treat that we can take away from us that Sister Donna prepares from a friend that has been very generous to us. So we have these days of monthly celebration that we can look forward to.
I'd also like to point out that the beauty of the photo that is your background, which I want to tell everyone, this is a photo that the practically hidden photographer, Sister Beverly Raway, she takes these lovely photos that I'm able to use for things for the center. And this beautiful, it's just as you were talking about pausing and noticing these things, we're seeing this lovely photo behind you. That's
one of the ways that I find joy, is just looking and seeing things with a different eye.
Yeah.
Sister Noemi taught that you look with the lens that you make with your fingers, like this a little tiny image, and you look that way like you're looking through the lens of a camera. And that's kind of the way I look at things when I'm on a walk. I'm looking at it from an angle that's, you know, what if that was framed as a photo? I'm seeing it that way when I go for a walk. In the woods, and it's a beautiful way. I find joy in plants that I'm taking care of, and the orchids in the dining room that I've been tending. And And putting puzzles together with there's a few of us that love to do that, and there's a couple of TV shows on public television that I attend to on Sunday nights, Masterpiece Theater presentation. Yeah. But there's with company. I probably wouldn't do it alone. I like being with people, doing, you know, and I like my alone time too, but the connection time.
You know, when we met to prep for this evening, Sister Beverly, I'm wondering if you would share what you shared with Sister Jeanne Ann and myself about how you start your morning. I think it's a beautiful practice that people can take with them, you know, after tonight's conversation. So would you mind?
No, not at all. I keep my shades down, of course, during the night. And first thing in the morning, I'm opening the shade. And we've moved into, you know, during a period of renovation, we've moved into the guest rooms. And so I have a view over Lake Superior, fourth floor, which I haven't had before. And so when I raise my shade in the morning, especially now that sunrise is a little later, I'm just looking out and I say, beautiful. There's always something beautiful to see, and it's never the same. And the lake is gorgeous. The colors that you see, it's never the same. And it reminded me that there is a cartoon that I saw once that somebody gave me, a cartoon strip, and it's one of those Lunig cartoons. The character is standing on a hillside looking at a sunrise or a sunset, I'm not sure which it is. And the quotation on it is, "Do it again, God. Do it again."
You know. Oh, that's beautiful. Do it again, God. We have a message in from Loris who says, not a glass half empty or half full, but be joyful that one has a glass and something to put in it.
Beautiful.
Right?
Beautiful.
How about you, Sister Jeanne Ann? Tell us a couple of places that you find joy in the midst of so much bad news all around us. Yeah.
Well, I think I start the day with a personal meditation and using Give Us This Day, which usually has a story about saints, canonized, not canonized, old, recent ones. And it just gives me courage to bring out the day when I see what they have gone through following the dreams, the vision, the call, and what they've done. And it has to be joy. It has to be grace. And this morning I was reading about, it was about Carita Kent, an artist. And Daniel Berrigan says, the joy in her work is riotous color. It was her gift to a gray world. And I know in my room I have some beautiful artwork painted by friends, photographs. I have pictures of my family that bring me joy. I have a picture of myself blowing bubbles. I have a few of these sayings that say, laugh loud and long. And laughter is it's healing. It's like an internal massage of all your organs. And again, sometimes you don't even need a reason to laugh. And it's contagious. And I think it brings joy. Not laughing at someone.
No.
I even have a brother. It's not my brother, Jim, however. And he sometimes tells jokes that really aren't that funny. Or sometimes we don't really get them. But it's just fun to laugh because we know it's our brother. We're laughing with him. And it just feels so good to laugh. You know, it doesn't have to be uproariously funny. And then, so just thinking about that. And then Carita Kent says, it is a huge danger to pretend that awful things do not happen.
Mm-hmm.
But you need enough hope to keep going. Hope is one of the the pillars of joy. And she says, I'm trying to make hope flowers grow out of darkness. And I think we're called to be co-creators. I think in your initial reading, we're supposed to bring joy, be bearers of joy, be bearers of hope. In the midst of that, somebody said that the opposite of joy is not sadness, but despair. And if there's despair, then there is no movement. You know, there is no zest for life. There's no meaning. And so if somehow in the midst of it, we can be light to one another and hope and joy.
Beautiful. And we're almost at our time. I think that's a beautiful way to close out our conversation. We could talk for a lot longer, and I would love to. But I want to thank you so much for being here and for getting us started on this exploration of joy this year. And I want to remind everyone that we hold these Benedictine conversations monthly. Next month, it'll be on October 11th, and our guest is Dr. Barbara McDonald, who is the college president at the College of St. Scholastica, right next door to the monastery. So looking forward to that too. But again, back to you, Sister Beverly and Sister Jeanne Ann. This has been very beautiful, very meaningful. And I'm hoping that you'd leave us with some words of wisdom. Sister Beverly, do you have anything to leave us with?
I do. You know, part of the title of our topic was about listening for the grace of joy. And Benedict's first word is listen in the rule of the holy rule. And that comes from the word abaudire, which in Latin means to listen intently or deeply. Mm-hmm. And I tell myself, and I tell, would like to tell others, to listen to your inner voice and obey the promptings that bring joy to yourself and to others. And I think that's in giving in small ways. I feel sometimes there's this, I should do this. I should bring, maybe I'll make a bouquet of wildflowers and bring them in. And I did it. There was this, and again, the pausing, looking for beauty around you and in the people in the natural world around you. So that's what I'd leave you with is listen and obey those inner promptings to connect with others.
That's a wonderful reminder. Thank you so much. How about you, Sister Jeanne Ann?
I'm just thinking about a quote from Jeremiah in his book on the Lamentations. And when things were hard and difficult, and he said, the joy and mercies of the Lord are new every morning. Hmm. And again, this is faith, this is hope, to do that the mercies and joy for myself and for our world, because sometimes it is overwhelming. And for serenity, which is peace, which is a pillar of joy, mm-hmm. God grant me the serenity to accept what I cannot change,
yeah.
And the wisdom to change what I can, and to be able to change what I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. What right. can I accept and what can I change? And so again, as Sister Beverly said, it's listening each day, each moment. What am I called? How am I called in little ways? Most of us in little ways, but I think, you know, we say, let there be peace on earth. Let it begin with me. Wow. Let there be joy and let it begin with me. Oh. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Blessings to all of you. Blessings to you, Sister Beverly, Sister Jeanne Ann. Thank you so much for being here with
us. Thank you
for inviting us.
Good night, everybody.